Hello, this is Dr. Christy Patton-Lokes, a chemical engineering professor at Missouri S&T. In this video lesson, we'll be starting to look at finding roots of equations computationally using VBA for Excel. And in this particular lesson, we are looking at the bisection method. We are in particular solving a cubic polynomial equation of state. We're doing this for chlorine using Pang-Robinson at, and I think I've worked this at 500 Kelvin and 150 bar. And the idea is that if you have a function and you just simply go through and evaluate it at random points, if you have one point that the function evaluates as positive and another point where the function evaluates as negative, that the midpoint would get you a closer guess to the actual root. And so what we do is we cut the section in half, okay? We evaluate the function, determine whether or not it's positive or negative, in other words, which endpoint am I replacing, and choose a new interval, cut that one in half, evaluate whether it's positive or negative, replace that one, cut the interval in half, and so forth, all the way down until we reach a good estimate. We're going to stop either using absolute error limits or relative error limits, and preferentially we use relative error limits. We're not going to get quite as caught up in the size of the x's that we're talking about. Either one makes good sense when you're talking about things that are on the order of, you know, one, but when you're talking about things that are very tiny or very large, this can make a big difference. So we will use relative error limits unless we specify otherwise. Now, the programming logic. This is a flow chart that Dr. Aldahan had created, and in this, the complete flow chart's over here. We'll look at little pieces of it one at a time. So we're going to start by entering our variables, okay? The negative and the positive x values. The xn is the one that's going to give a function less than zero. Xp is the one that's giving a positive. And we're also going to tell it how many iterations we're going to allow. Now, what isn't listed here is that we also actually need to tell it what is our error limit. We could just build that into the program, but it's nice to have that flexibility for the user. And then we're going to start by setting our iterations with I equal to 1. Once I do that, I'm going to start my looping. So my first time, I'm just going to take the given xn and xp, I'm going to add those up, divide by 2, in other words, average them. I'm then going to evaluate the function at this new value of x. If it's negative, then I'm going to assign it to be x new as x negative. If it's positive, I'm going to assign it to be x positive. So therefore, we're just going to do a little test here. And when I do that, if it was true, so it was negative, I'm going to say xn is now x new, and I'm going to take this error and test it. So this is the relative error formula. I'm looking to see whether or not it's less than my epsilon. If it is, then I've solved. If not, then I need to go back. So I'm going to increase my counter by 1, make sure it isn't more than the maximum counter I said, okay, and this will eventually come back in to guessing a new x new. Now the other option was that it was false. If it's false, then I'm hoping it's going to be positive, okay? If it's positive, if x new is greater than 0, then true would be that I'm going to say xp is x new. This is a t. And I'll calculate the error, and I'll go on like I did before. And if not, then I have that I've actually found the answer. I've got x new gives a value of f that's exactly 0, right? I tested negative, I tested positive. So this t and this f are incorrect. Now then, at some point with any of these paths, I could come to the point where I'm within my error limits. And so therefore, I'm just going to, you know, change my root iteration. I'm going to print my answer. I'll give messages, and then I will stop the program. Okay? So let's look at what I did as writing code for this. Now, this was in my spreadsheet that we've looked at in the past. This is the first two values for the bisection method that I had done. And of course, we had gone through and done this manually. And so these are my first two guesses. One had a positive and one had a negative F value. And I put in now a relative error. So what I need to do first is get this information out of the spreadsheet and into my VBA program. Okay. I also need to check and make sure that the user truly chose something that was positive and something that was negative. And there's one last thing that we need to do. You may remember this from your programming classes, but you can get better performance from your program if you will dimension some of your variables. Or some people say that you always want to dimension all of your variables. But I want the counter that I'm using to be just an integer. And all of those X values, I would like them to be double precision. I would like to carry out the full 16 places that are available to me for data storage. So I've done that, and you can add to this list later as you think of other things. Then I'm going to go to the sheet. I'm going to select my cell, and I'm going to say X1 is the top value and X2 is the bottom value. Now then, I want to evaluate this function and see whether it's positive or negative. So I named the function myFunc. We'll come back to this in just a minute in the next slide, but let's assume that this is a meaningful function. So I'm going to evaluate the function for x1, the top value, and if it's positive, then I'm going to name x positive is that value. And then let's jump down here. If not, then x negative is that value. Okay, so this is either going to define this as being x negative or x positive. I have, however, this issue of what about that other guy, x2? Okay, so if I have x2, if x2 also evaluates the function as positive, then I'm in trouble. This is a bad choice. So I've just said, let's give a message box, please enter a different value of x in cell M4. So this gives it back to the user so they can fix it. If not, then we'll go ahead and say, well, this was x positive, the other one is x negative. And the same thing down here. So if the other is, again, I'm wanting opposite signs. So this one will give me an x positive, and then give me a warning if not. Okay, so far it's read these z values and it has found this function. So what is this function? Well, to build a function, what you're going to do is go down below the end sub and type in function and name your function. And I have one argument z that I want to travel from the other function or from the subroutine. Now I'm going to, in this case, do a polynomial, and I want to read the constants from the spreadsheet, so I've done that. Now the reason I've built this function separate is because, one, I need to call it lots of times from the subroutine, and two, I would like to be able to just change this and not have to change the entire rest of my subroutine. Okay, so this allows me, if I wanted to switch to some function that was maybe I wanted to find the root of x times cosine of x, I could look at it by doing this here and only have to change things in one location. So this is the advantage of building this as a function. And so now then, I'm just going to call this every time we saw earlier as my func of z. Now let's look quickly at the rest of the subroutine. So this is my loop where I'm going through and finding the next value of x, checking whether or not I'm close enough, and eventually giving a result or continuing the loop. So first I need to know what the error limit is. So I put that in cell 03. And then I start my counter. Now remember, I made the counter of integer. I'm going to go 1 to 20. If it takes more than 20 times, then just quit. This is not working well. Okay, so I calculate x nu using the average, and then I look at the error limit. Okay, if I'm within the error limit, then I'm going to print the answer. So I'm going to go to the active cell and say the answer is the cell below. I'll put in the value, and then I'm going to let us know what the counter was at that time to see if maybe I want to raise this. Maybe 20 isn't adequate. Now, if I do this, I want it to just stop, so I'm going to just set the counter to 20, the maximum value. I'll end that if. Okay, so it checked the error limit. And then now that I need to decide, is x nu going to be my next round's x negative or x positive? So I'm just simply going to check that. And then I'll continue. So let's now look at this in Excel. So let me pull that up. I have all of that programmed in. Okay. And if we come over here, here is the cell. And this has lots of other stuff we've been working with, but these are the values of the coefficients for the cubic polynomial. These are the z values it's reading. This is the relative error I'm looking for. And if you'll recall, developer macros run. And I got to 1 times 10 to the negative 5th in 11 rounds. And this was my answer. I can play games where I've changed that and I can run it again. And it took 14 and it got me an extra decimal place. So you can play with this. You can switch our choices of what we put in as our two Z's here. Check and see if you can, you know, like put in 0.63 and 0.64 and see what it does then. Play with this. We're going to next be doing the same thing using the regular falsy method. Thank you.